As you all, if you don't know me, I'm Marc Quilla. I'm here a PhD student at the University of Barcelona. And today I'm going to talk about how we can constrain effective field theories for the baryon-baryon interactions with lattice QCD. So this work has been done within the NPLQCD collaboration. So an outline of the talk. So I'll start with a bit of motivation. Then I will talk the problems that we have when we want to study nuclear physics with lattice QCD. Then I will talk of what type of effective field theory we use to describe our baryon-baryon systems. And finally, I will show some results at different baryon masses. So let's start with a bit of motivation. So we want to study baryon-baryon interaction, especially at low energies, which is the regime of nuclear physics. But we have a problem if we want to study this interaction directly from the fundamental theory, which is QCD. So at low energies, what happens is that the coupling constant gets too large to perform perturbation methods and analyze this system. So what people usually do is use effective field theories, where the degrees of freedom now are not quarks and gluons, but instead are nucleons, hyperons, and maybe mesons, baryons. And then all the hard physics that is not known is put into the form of quantum interactions. And the strength of these quantum interactions is given by these CIs, which we will call low energy constants. So now, since we cannot compute these constants directly from QCD, what we do is we match them to experimental data. So we know we have lots of data for the nucleon-nucleon sector. What happens when we go to the sector when we include, for example, one strange quark? So this, now we are in the realm of hyperons like the lambda, sigma, or cascade. So here is a plot taken from this paper where I'm plotting the total cross-section as a function of the center of mass momentum, the momentum of the lab. And you can see several things. So here on the top rows, in these two plots, this is data for the nucleon-nucleon channels. And you can see there are lots of points with very small uncertainties. But then if we look at the plots for the hyperon channels, we can see that the lightest hyperon, the lambda, has still bit quite a lot of points, but still the errors are very large. But if we move on to heavier hyperons, we start to have less and less points with larger and larger uncertainties. And also the situation through time is not right. So after the 1990s, we only have added a few points with very large uncertainties. So this is given because it is very difficult to study hyperon nucleon and hyperon scattering experiments because it is not possible to make a stable beam of hyperon. They decay via the weak interaction really fast. But the situation is going to be improved. There's an experiment at JPER, day 40, that wants to, when it's increasing the statistics in these channels, in the sigma channels. So we will see an improvement very recently here in the future. So this is information about two body forces. What if we want to learn about three body forces, for example? Then what we want to do is to look at the nuclear chart and see what elements we have discovered. So for example, for normal nuclei, we have discovered more than 1,000 elements, and we know them with very good precision, the energy levels. But again, if we include hyperons in the systems, we talk about hypernuclei. And for example, for the strangeness minus one hypernuclei, which is nuclei where we have a lambda or a sigma, there we only have observed around 40 elements. And if we move on to strangeness minus two, so with a cascade or two lambdas, we have only observed three. So really, this really does not help when constraining two and three body forces for the hyperon-nucleon and hyperon-hyperon interaction. But again, there's ongoing investigation, again at JPER, but also at JLab, where they want to study the spectrum of hypernuclei, and also in future facilities like in Panda in Germany, where they will also study this type of nuclei. But this is not all, these are not the only methods used. There's, for example, new constraints coming from femtoscopy, where they look at the correlation of the momentum of proton-proton and heavy ion collisions, and they are able to detect hyperons and observe the correlation functions. So for example, at star at Rick or at Alice, at LHC or at Heights. So this really helps compare the data with experimental, with theoretical models, but still extracting information directly from these correlation functions gives too large uncertainties. So what our purpose is to complement all these experimental data with some theoretical calculations. And from what is known now, the only way to do non-perturbative calculations from first principles is by using lattice QCD, which is systematically improvable. So the idea behind lattice QCD is to use the path integral formalism to compute expected value of some operator. So here Z is the partition function of QCD, Q, Q bar are quarks and antiquarks, and A is the gluon field, and S is the action. But we cannot simply compute this on the computer. We have to do several changes, modifications. So the first one is that we have to work in a finite volume. We cannot work in infinite volume. So we have to choose the volume very wisely. So it has to be big enough so that our systems fit inside, but it cannot be too big because it would be too expensive to compute. And then to reach the limit of infinite volume, so we can connect with reality, we can use, for example, we can help with EFTs that tell us how the physical quantities depend on the volume, and then we can extrapolate to infinite volume. Another modification that we have to do is that we have to discretize the spacetime. We cannot work on the continuum. So here we introduce some lattice spacing, which usually is called A, here I call it B. And one thing that when we discretize the spacetime is that, for example, in the action, there are derivatives. So these derivatives become now finite differences. Since we work with QCD, we always want to maintain local gauge invariants. So when we work with finite differences, to have the product of quark fields at different lattice sites become gauge invariant, we have to reformulate how we use the gluon field. So now instead of working with A in lattice, we work with what we call the link variable U, which is related to the gluon field, which connects quarks at different lattice sites to maintain gauge invariance. Again, we can connect with the real world by doing an extrapolation to lattice spacing zero. So one performs different calculations and different lattice spacings and then does an extrapolation. And lastly, the last change that we have to do is that since this integral is very high dimensional, we want to perform this integral via Monte Carlo methods. The problem, so we would like to assign, for example, this exponential as a probability distribution function, so we can sample our gluon fields and compute our operator as the mean value. But we can see that this is imaginary, so this is not very well behaved. So what we do is we rotate to imaginary time or Euclidean time. So when we do this rotation, this exponential becomes real, so we can identify this exponential as a probability distribution function, and then compute the expected value of operator as just the mean value of operator under these gluon fields, which are sampled according to this probability distribution function. So what type of operators are we interested in? So we want to study, for example, the energy levels, which is what we are. We want to compute two-point correlation functions, which tell us the amplitude of creating a state from the vacuum at some time zero and let it evolve after some time tau, and then we annihilate it. And then this operator that we create and annihilate has to have the right quantum numbers of the state we want to study. And here we have full control on the spin of the state we want to study, the parity, the flavor, etc. So we have full control on what we study. Moreover, in the end, we have to project it to have some well-defined momentum. So this is what the sum does. So as an example, let's compute, for example, the baryon. So here is the parameter that we would use to study the baryon. If we insert it here in this formula, we can use weak theorem to contract the quark fields. So in the end, what we have to compute are the propagators, which tell us that there's an U quark propagating from zero to time tau, and then the D quark, since it's an antiquark, is propagating backwards in time. But this is not telling us how to extract the energies of the system. This is how we can compute on the computer. So to extract the energies, we have to compute the spectral decomposition of this object, which can be done by inserting a complete set of states here in between. And after some algebra, one can see that this function is really a sum of z. These z are overlap factors that tell us how good our operator couples to some state n. And then we have the exponential of the energy of this energy level n. So in the end, what we have to do is we have to fit exponentials to the correlator to extract the energy. So maybe you are aware that most of the calculations for related to nuclear physics, which are mainly done with these collaborations, are done using heavier than physical quark masses. Now there has been some recently calculations close to the physical mass by the QCD calculation, but still the rest use heavier than physical quark masses. So why is that? So to look at that, let's look again at the correlator. And a simpler way to look at the correlator is to look at what we call the effective mass or effective energy plot, which is the ratio of correlator at different times. And then for a large enough imaginary time, this object should plateau to the lowest energy of the system, to the ground state. So for example, here is for the baryon. We see that in the beginning, we have excited state contamination, as we would expect. But then for large enough time, we see that this plateaus to the ground state of the energy, which is the mass of the baryon. The same for the nucleon. In the beginning, we have excited state contamination, but then we see that it should plateau, but then the errors of the points start to increase exponentially and we lose the signal completely. So this is what we call the signal to noise problem, which scales for the nucleon like this. It scales like mass of the nucleon minus 3/2 mass of the baryon. If we have a hyperon, this measure would be the one which can be produced with the quarks of the hadron. But for the nucleon, we have the mass of the nucleon and here the mass of the baryon. So we see that it degrades exponentially with time. But then if we do nuclear physics, meaning that we do more than one body, two, three, etc., we have this factor A here multiplying in front, which speeds up even faster the signal to noise degradation. So why do we do lattice calculations with heavier than physical quark masses? Well, if you look at this difference using quarks at the physical point, we see that this difference is around 700 MeV. However, if we would use heavier quarks, which would give us a baryon mass of 800 MeV, this difference becomes smaller, becomes 400 MeV. So what's the main reason why we do simulations with unphysical quark masses? But then again, the main purpose is to connect theoretical calculations with experimental values. So we say, no, no, we want to do calculations at the physical point. So the way to go around this problem is we have to increase the statistics so we can move this signal to noise problem further in time. To increase the statistics, what you have to do is we have to compute more propagators. So as I said before, two-point correlation functions are computed by products of propagators. The problem is that to compute these propagators, we have to solve this type of linear equation. And the cost of inverting the Dirac operator goes as the inverse of the mass of the quark. So as we go to lighter and lighter quarks, the problem to invert this matrix becomes more difficult and more difficult. So that's another reason why people do calculations at physical quark masses. And then another problem that's independent of the masses of the quark, but it's a problem for people that do nuclear physics, is the number of contractions. So for the baryon, as I showed you earlier, it only has one type of contraction. But then, for example, if we look at the proton, it has two different types of contractions. And then if you go to heavier and heavier systems with more particles, the number of contractions grow in a naive way as the factorial number of quarks that we have in the system. So this really explodes even as we go to 3 and 4 systems. There have been some advancements in trying to reduce this problem, but still is also one of the main costs of doing calculations for nuclear physics with 2, 3, and 4 body systems. But despite all these problems, people have done physics with more than one body. So an example here is, here I'm showing results of the NPLQCD collaboration back in 2012. here the calculations they did was with a world with the three quarks having the same mass, resulting in a perimass of a candidate MeV. Here they have exact SU3 fiber symmetry, and they don't include electromagnetic interactions. And the thing to see is that for all the systems that they have computed, they found that they were all bound at this baryon mass. And an interesting thing to look at is if we look at the error of the energy. So as we increase to more and more bodies, to more and more from 2 to 4 body, you can see that the error of the binding energy also increase due to this problem of the signal to noise degradation. So now let's look at what we will discuss here. Here we'll discuss these two papers. The difference between these both is that the first I was not involved with, and what they did was to set all the masses of the quark to be the same, and this value is the physical mass of the strange quark. And in this limit, as I said in the previous slide, that is exact SU3 fiber symmetries, so both baryon and the kaon on all the mesons have the same mass, so which is around 800 MeV. The second paper, which I have to say has been accepted for physical review D, here we have that the masses of the light quarks up and down now are not the same as the strange quark, which is still fixed to its physical value, but now they are lighter, still not the physical value, but lighter. So now SU3 fiber symmetry is explicitly broken. So the baryon and the kaon will have different masses. In this case, the baryon is 450 and the kaon 600 MeV. And what type of systems do we study? So here we only focus on octet systems. So baryons with a spin 1/2 and positive parity. And then if we stayed still at the SU3 fiber symmetric point, from group theory, we know that the product of two octets is not to have 64 different channels, but that they are grouped into 6 different irreducible representations or rewraps. So at 800 MeV, since they have exact SU3, it's enough to label the systems by the rewrap they belong to. So here they studied these 4 rewraps. However, at 450, this degeneracy is broken. So now the systems that live within the same rep, in principle, now we have differently. So instead of only studying 4 channels, now at 450, what we have to do is we have to study these 9 different channels. And they range from strangeness 0, so here in the 27, we have the dinucleon, NN, or at 10 bar, we have the deuteron. And then we go up to strangeness -4, so cascade. And then, for example, also in the 10, we also studied the sigma n spin triplet state, which is also very interesting to study, and a lot more. So how do we describe these baryon-baryon channels with effective field theory? Since we are only at low energies, we consider a pionless EFT, so we only consider contact interactions. And a leading order, we have 6 different terms. This makes sense because since this Lagrangian is a SU3 symmetric, we said in the beginning that the product of two octets gives 6 different rewraps. So now it makes sense that the Lagrangian here, a leading order, only has 6 terms, which in the end, these 6 terms will be regrouped to have a coefficient for each of the rewraps. So from the lattice data, we can access this combination of coefficients and not them separately. So here B is the matrix of the baryons, and IJ are the spin indices only up and down. So this is a leading order, which is enough, for example, for the study at 800 MeV. But then if we go to next to leading order, we have 2 different contributions. The first one is still S3 symmetric, which is the inclusion of derivatives. And since you only study the S wave, these are the only terms that we need. Again, since it is SU3 symmetric, we only have 6 coefficients, which again can be grouped to have a single coefficient for each rep. But the same order, we can also include this term with chi, where chi is the matrix of the quark masses, which can be written in terms of the masses of the mesons. So if we were at the SU3 symmetric point, this matrix would be diagonal, and this would be only a shift of the leading order coefficients, and that would be it. But for symmetry breaking, at the symmetry breaking, which is what happens at 450, this matrix is no longer diagonal. So we will have extra contributions that would affect the leading order terms. And again, since this type of Lagrangian is not SU3-symmetric, we no longer expect to only have 6 terms, and there are 12. The number of independent ways to couple this chi to the baryon matrices. And again, also, this is interesting to study symmetry breaking coefficients, because experimentally, it is really difficult to constrain them. So as far as I know, only one combination of these coefficients has been constrained with data, because as I showed you in the beginning, the data for baryon-baryon scattering is really bad. So they could only use the ones from, I think, nucleon-nucleon and sigma and data to constrain. So here we want to see if with the lattice setup we can improve the situation. So how can we compute all these coefficients with a lattice? Oh, well, before that, there's another interesting limit to study here, not only the SU3, but in the large number, in the limit of large number of colors, Kaplan and Savage predicted that there's an SU6 spin flavor symmetry. So in this limit, instead of the 6 coefficients needed to describe the whole baryon-baryon interaction, here only 2 are needed, A and B. And in principle, here we can also include the decoupled baryons, the ones with the spin 3/2. But since we don't study them, here I'm not showing. So maybe you are more familiar with SU4 Wigner symmetry, which is in this limit, it's only in the 2 flavor sector, where both nucleon-nucleon channels behave the same. So here is a larger symmetry which encapsulates this SU4. So how can we compute all these coefficients A and B and the ones from the SU3 Lagrangian? So what we do is we match these coefficients to momentum expansion of the scattering amplitude. So here A is the scattering length of the channel with baryons B1 and B2. R is the effective range. M bar is the reduced mass of the system. And then we have here at the top all these coefficients that come from momentum independent terms. So with no derivatives, we have the leading order and the ones from the symmetry breaking, which we have absorbed this term here in the coefficient. And then in the second line, we have the one coming from momentum dependent terms, so the one that have derivatives. So now here we have to be careful if our systems are natural or not. So what do I mean by that? So if the system is natural, this means that the scattering length and effective range of the systems are of the same order. So this matching can be done at the three-level expansion. So we don't need to introduce no renormalization scale. However, for unnatural channels, for a natural interaction, this means that the scattering length is much larger than the effective range. So this is what happens for the 2 nucleon channels at the physical point, where we see that this ratio is always smaller than 1. So when this happens, all the momentum independent contributions have to be summed up to all orders in perturbation theory. So we have them to introduce this renormalization scale mu. So, and we set it to be the cutoff of the theory. So we will study both situations. So for the natural case, we will send mu to 0. And for the natural case, we will send mu to be the mass of the baryon, which is the cutoff of our baryonless EFT. Okay, so let's start to show some results. So let's start with the 800 and maybe results. So as I said, this situation, they had the 3 light quarks to be degenerate. Then this situation have the pi mass of 800 maybe, and only one lattice spacing was studied. Here I have to say that at the moment, all baryon-baryon studies have performed calculations at a single lattice spacing. The continuum limit has not been performed, although we expect it to not be to not modify quite the results. This is still unknown because, but it's still too expensive to do calculations at the several lattice spacings. What it is done is that these calculations are performed at different volumes, so that then we can do the infinite volume extrapolation. So here, for example, yeah.
Can I ask, is there a simple reason why you are not expecting probing different values of P will alter the results you get?
Yeah, because in principle, when we discretize the action, you can set your discretized errors. In principle, the naive one would be to be at order A, so at order B, or at this spacing, but you can increase this to be at order B squared. So in principle, you can push back these discretization errors by using better and better actions. But still, until one, I mean, this is unknown. This is what we expect. But until we perform the calculations, we really don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Then another thing we do is that we produce correlation functions with different mirrorings, meaning that when we create the quark or destroy, we don't do it from a point source. We do it from an extended source, which we expect to be better coupled to the ground state of the systems. And having different correlation functions, which in principle couple different with excited states but have the same ground state energy, helps us when do the fitting and extracting the mass and ground state of the system. And also, these correlation functions are built not only at rest, which has set a couple better to ground state, but also we produced this correlation function for boosted systems, so having the same momenta for both baryons, which in the center of mass frame, still we expect to have the same center of mass momenta, but also we produce these correlation functions with back-to-back momenta. So now this, compared with the ones at rest that couple to ground state, the ones with back-to-back momenta couple primarily to the force excited state. So once we know all that, we can start looking at the data. So the first thing to look at is to looking at the single baryon sector. Here, since we are at the SU3 fibersymmetric point, all baryons have the same mass, which is, in this case, around 1.6 GeV. And here, from the effective mass plot, you can see that the energy does not really depend on the volume that one computes this baryon. So this is good, but still one can perform the infinite volume extrapolations. And again, it sees that it is compatible with all the calculations at the different volumes. So this is for the single baryon. Then we move on to the two baryon sector. And here, for example, I'm plotting at the top row. This is the effective energy plot of the system. So at the bottom, we have the ones for the baryons are at rest with the two colors for the different smearings. So you can see that the excited state contributions are different, but then at the end, the plateau region, the one, the ground state region is the same. And then at the top, we have the ones with back-to-back momenta that couple to the force excited state. This is the energy plots. And then at the bottom, I'm showing the effective energy plot. So this is the difference between the energy and two non-interacting nucleons. And the shift from zero, meaning that there's some interaction happening within the two baryons. And still, again, you can see here that there's some region where this effective mass plateaus, which is a constant, and then you can fit this and extract the energy shift of the system. So if you do that for all, in this case, the four channels, you get a total of 10 kinematic points for each channel. And looking at the ground state energy for each channel, you see, like looking at these points, you see that they all lie below zero. So in principle, you should expect that these are bound states. But since these are only finite volume energies and not infinite volume, you are not really sure. So to be sure, what we have to do is we have to extrapolate this to infinite volume. And then also with these finite volume energies, we can extract the scattering parameters of the channels. So to do that, we use the Lucia formalism, which tells us how to relate the center of mass momentum with the phase shift, the Keiko tangent delta. So first, if we expand this function in the negative K-square region, this is the region where we can extract the binding momenta. And then this formula tells us how to extrapolate to infinite volume. So if we do that, well, they did that. And they found that the four different channels are bound at this baryon mass. there's one exception, which is the one for that systems in the 10 Europe. So if you remember, in this Europe, there's one channel, for example, the sigma n spin triplet, which is expected to be very repulsive at the physical point. So here at the time that maybe it seems to be bound, but still with a smaller magnitude compared to the rest of the systems, and also with the uncertainties compatible with being not bound. But that's, this is what they found for the binding energies. Sorry. So then, if we look at the scattering parameters, what we want to do is that use all the points that are below the Tichenor cut, so we can use effective range expansion, which tell us how we can relate the K cotangent delta with the scattering parameters. So we have A is the scattering length, R the effective range, and then we have higher order parameters. So they did that, and then they tried to do several fits. So one using only two parameters, which is the one in green, and then the one in pink using three parameters, including the shape parameter. So when they did that, they observed that they extract consistent scattering parameters, as you can see here in this summary. And then an interesting thing to look at is at the ratio of the effective range and the scattering length. And you can see that this ratio for all the channels is below one. So in principle, this is showing that these systems are unnatural at 800 MeV. So once we have these scattering parameters, we can start to constrain the coefficients from the effective field theory. So at 800 MeV, we already know that we have SU3 Fayol symmetry. So we don't have to worry about the symmetry breaking terms. So one, we can already compute this C27, C10 bar, C10, and C8A coefficients directly using the scattering length. And then an interesting thing is that we can match these coefficients with the ones coming from SU6. So we can have a relation between the Cs from SU3 with the A and B from the SU6. But as you can see, the coefficients from SU3 are always a combination of A and B. So to separate both contributions, what they did was to take in pairs of these different systems to separate A and B. So once they did that, they concluded that in both the natural and unnatural case, all the extractions between the different systems are compatible with each other. So they assume that SU6 is an approximate symmetry at 800 MeV. So once you know that SU6 is approximate symmetry, you can use these average values of A and B to do the reverse. So now that you have A and B, you can compute directly all the leading order SU6 coefficients C1 to C6. Because in the beginning, I said that you from the lattice, we can only access these combinations from each UF. But once we have A and B, we can compute each C's separately. So once they did that, and for the natural case, one really does not observe nothing special, but for the natural case, one sees that all coefficients are very close to zero or zero, except one, the C5, which is the largest one. So here, they are observing an accidental SU16 symmetry. Why 16? Because we have an octet and the two spins channels. So they say that the whole octet-octet systems in both the spin channels behave the same. So only one coefficient is really needed to describe the whole 64 different channels. But then one might ask, where does this SU16 come from? Because we know the SU6 comes from in the limit of large number of colors, but where does this SU16 come from? Well, this was investigated later on. And by these people, Silas Bean, David Kaplan, Natalie Klo, and Martin Savage. And they proposed that if you conjecture this new conjecture, which is that there's entanglement suppression, is the dynamical property of QCD. So imposing entanglement suppression, one recovers in the three-flavor sector this SU16 symmetry. if you restrict to the two flavor sector, you recover SU4 weakness symmetry with the entanglement separation. But in the three flavor sector, you don't recover SU6, you go directly to SU16. And then a fun fact, so the idea of using entanglement to constrain some effective field, some quantum field theory was already done back in 2017 here in a group in Barcelona led by Alba Cervera, where they constrained QED and the weak interactions, but instead of imposing entangled suppression, they imposed maximum entanglement. So this is just a fun fact. So this is our results for 800 MeV. Now let's go to 450. Now we have here two degenerate light quarks plus a heavier strange quark. So now the pion is 450. Again, we only do one lattice spacing. We do several volumes, again, to perform the infinite volume limit. We also produce correlation functions with different smearing, so we can extract better the ground state energy. And also we produce correlation functions not only at rest, but with boost, so with the same momenta for both baryons, and with back-to-back momenta. Now, SU3 is explicitly broken by the different values of the masses of the quarks. So the baryons will no longer have this, all the baryons will no longer have the same mass. So now, for example, the nucleon has a mass of around 1.2 GeV, and then the cascade has around 1.4 GeV. And an interesting thing to look here from these effective energy plots is the signal to noise problem comparing the nucleon systems with the hyperon one. So you can see that this signal to noise problem is much worse for the nucleons because the difference of the mass of the nucleon and three halves mass of the pion is more big, is bigger than when we compute the similar difference, but for the cascade or for the sigma. So that's the reason why, as I said in the beginning, some collaborations have performed calculations at the near the physical point, but they have not computed the nucleon-nucleon channels. What they do is they compute very strange systems like omega-omega or proton-omega. So this is the case for a single nucleon. Then we move on to the two-nucleon case, two-baryon case. And the situation here is a bit worse compared to the 800 MeV, because now here the single to noise problem is worse as we decrease the mass of the quarks. And sometimes it's very difficult to identify the region where your effective mass plateaus and reaches the ground state energy. So to avoid to having to fitting by eye where the plateau region is, what we did is we created a more elaborated fitting strategy, which was first shown here in this paper. And let me summarize here a bit. So instead of fitting the effective mass, we fit directly the correlation functions, which we know are a sum of exponentials. So the first step is to fix which minimum time and maximum time you want to fit, so your fitting range. So once we have selected that, we do a model selection. So meaning that how many we choose how many exponentials we want to fit in this time range. And this is done using the Kike information criteria. So this criteria tells us that if you want to add another exponential to your model, your chi-square per degree of freedom has to decrease by 1 unit. So if this happens, you can add the extra exponential. If this doesn't happen, you don't need to add it. So once we have this model selection, we pass some test on the fitting model, on the model that we have fit. So for example, we use several minimizers and we see that all the ground state energies that we have extracted from these different minimizers are the same within some range. Another fit that we do, another test that we do, is that instead of fitting with the full covariance matrix, we do the fit, but with only the diagonal. So doing an uncorrelated fit. This in principle should be, the resulting fit should be different, but not that different, so it should be still close. So if it's not too close, we reject the fit. So after several tests I perform, we see if they have all passed them, if they have all been passed. And if they have, we accept the fit. And if they don't, we reject. Then we repeat that over all the possible t-min and t-max values. So we have a full swipe of all the possible time ranges where we can fit the correlation function.
Mark, so, can I ask you something?
Yeah.
So now you have this function with several exponentials. Can you use this method to get energies not only of the ground state, but also of excited states as well?
Yes. The problem is that if you really want to extract excited states energy and not only the ground state, you really have to go and do a variational problem. Because here, here it's usually uncertainties that you get on the first excited state are really big compared to the ground state energy. So really, you can extract the excited states, but with really big uncertainties. So really, you have to go to the variational and do different operators and extract it.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. So once we have done all this for all the possible t-min and t-max, we combined the resulting ground state energies by the p value, so how good the chi square is, and also we combined them, weighting them by the variance of the result. So if you have larger uncertainty, the weight in the when you combine them is going to be smaller. So once we do all that, we believe that we have a better estimation of the statistical for sure, but also the systematics of the fitting. So because we have really varied all possible time ranges and also all possible fitting possibilities, all possible exponentials. So once we have that, once we do that, we get 12 kinematic points for each system. And now we see that in these channels, the ones where they belong to the 10 EREV, so at 800 MeV, the binding energy of these systems was really close to zero. Now we see that the ground state of these systems is zero, or consistent with zero, or even positive. So now these systems are no longer bound at this pion mass. But still the rest, all the ground state energies are below zero, but still we have to perform the infinite volume limit to really be sure if they are bound or not. So we did that, they really are bound at the pion mass, and then we can use the result from 800 MeV and do some preliminary study by performing some extrapolation to the physical point. Here we have, I have to say that this form of extrapolation of extrapolation of the binding energy with a pion mass is not known. Some extrapolation forms are known, for example, when you want to extrapolate some of the axial charge or some other quantity, but for two baryon systems, these quantities still are not known how one has to extrapolate them to the physical point. So since we only have 2 points to the extrapolation, we do some very simple forms, one which is linear and another is quadratic with the baryon mass. And then we compare these results with experimental, which is only the case for nucleon-nucleon, or with phenomenological models. Like here we chose meson exchange models or effective field theories. So for example, for the deuteron, if we compare our extrapolated result with experiment, we see that it's still compatible but with huge error bars. But then if we look at the strangeness systems, which are the ones we are interested, we see that in some cases, our very naive predictions are in agreement with the ones coming from these phenomenological models. In some cases, it seems to prefer systems that are more bound than the predictions. And in others, there's a bit of a disagreement between our results and the ones from coming from effective field theories and Mason exchange models. Right. This is the case for the cascade nucleon spin triplet state, which lives in the eight antisymmetric ERAP. So in this case, most of the models predict that this channel is attractive, but does not make a bound, does not produce a bound system. The only case is for this extended soft core. However, our results predict that these systems might be bound at the physical point. So this is only telling us that we have to perform simulations near the physical point to really make conclusive statements to say if this system is really bound or not. This is just very preliminary. So this is for the binding energies. Now let's look for the scattering parameters. Again, we can only use points below the T-channel cut to perform the effective range expansion. The problem now is that the T-channel cut, since we have decreased the mass of the baryon, is below some of our points coming from the data coming with back-to-back momenta. So we cannot longer use them. So now we have less points due to the effective range expansion fit. And also due to the synchrotronics problem, these points are also have larger uncertainties. So here one problem that we have encountered is that when we try to do a fit with two or three parameters, these do not really match. So the problem we see is that with the three parameter, while the scattering length agrees with the fit coming from the two parameter, the shape parameter that we extract from this fit is too large compared to the previous parameter. So this seems that this series seems to not converge. So we reject this three-point fit, this three-parameter fit, and we only keep the one from coming from two parameters. So this is the result. Again, you can see now we have quite large uncertainties. But if you look again at the ratio of the effective range and scattering length, for the cases where this ratio is resolved, we see that this ratio is still below one. So still this system show unnaturalness. So now again, we could still constrain our the low energy constants from effective field theory using the scattering length, but now the uncertainty is quite large. So we can do an alternative. So we can constrain these constants by fixing the scattering length to the binding momenta. So this relation is really easy to find. So we know that for a bound system, there's a pole in the scattering amplitude. So if we set the momenta to be the binding momenta, one finds this relation. So here, setting only the leading order term of the effective range expansion, only the scattering length, one finds this relation, that the scattering length is the same as the binding momenta. And the thing is that the binding momenta that we can extract is with much better accuracy than the way we can extract the scattering length by fitting the Kekutangent data. So we will compare both extractions, one where the scattering length is extracted by doing the fitting to the effective range expansion, and another where we have fixed the scattering length with the binding momenta. So here we have to first study the SU3 symmetry, because now the masses of the quarks are different. So the way we can separate the symmetry preserving coefficients from the symmetry breaking ones are only for the 27 ERAP channels. And that's the case because in these channels, what we have is that the leading order term is the same for all the channels, but the symmetry breaking terms, the coefficients are the same, but then we have different numerical factors in front. So we can do a system of equation and separate both contributions. So we can do that for these two systems, and then sigma n, the sigma sigma channel does not have symmetry breaking contributions. And here the same for the cascade sigma and cascade cascade, where these terms are the same in both channels, but the numerical factors in front are not. So if we do that, we can separate both the C27 coefficient and the coefficients going, related to the symmetry breaking. So we can see that the C27 extracted for channels are compatible. And you can see that the gray points are used the scattering length from the effective range expansion fit, which has larger error bars, and the black points come from the fitting the scattering length to the binding momenta, which has a smaller error bars. So that C27 coefficient is compatible between all the channels. And then if you look at the symmetry breaking terms, we see that these coefficients are compatible with zero. So in principle, this would tell us that SU3 is still an approximate symmetry. But this is not the only clue that we have. We have only seen that there's similarities between bending energies and the scattering parameters of systems within the semi-rep. And also, back in 2015, they analyzed the Gell-Mann-Okobamas relation, which is this relation between the baryon masses. And they found that the violation of this relation is an order of magnitude smaller compared to experimental value. So this is all telling us that SU3 is still approximate symmetry, even though the masses of the quarks are different. So if we assume SU3, we can check, move on and check SU6. So here, to do this connection, we have assumed that not only the coefficients from the symmetry making coefficients from the T27 are zero, but also coefficients for the 10 bar and the systems in 8A are also zero. So if we assume that, we can make this connection between A and B. Again, we have to take a pair of systems between one, for example, one from the 27 and one from the 8A, so we can separate the terms from A and B. And if we do that, we again see that there's some, that the different extractions are compatible and give consistent values for A and B. So again, once we have A and B, we can go back and compute all the leading order coefficients C1 to C6. So if we compare with 800 MeV, now we see that again, for the natural case, not much of a conclusion can be extracted, but for the natural case, a C5 is still the largest coefficient, but the rest are now no longer zero. Are small, but not zero. So compared to 800 MeV, where they observe very clearly this accidental SU16, now we only see a remnant of this SU16 symmetry. So let me conclude. Here I've shown you how we can use lattice QCD to constrain effective field theories, especially in the sector where there's very few experimental data. And although calculations are performed not at the physical point, they are very useful to reveal symmetries more clearly. So for example, at the 100 MeV, it was shown that there's this accidental SU16 symmetry, which was corroborated using a separate analysis with entanglement suppression. And then at 450, despite having the quite different masses, there's an approximate SU3 and SU6 symmetry. So I have not talked about here that there's some discrepancies between different methods, like the variation or the Hall QCD method, which need to be understood, and there's progress going in this direction. And also that calculations near the physical baryon mass are being performed. So you should expect results maybe in 1 year or so. And then other projects that I am related here in the NPLQCD collaboration is that we study also interactions of hadrons with external currents. So for example, very recently we released a paper where we talk about momentum fraction and how lattice QCD can help constrain experimental data even for the momentum fraction in helium-3. And also, very recently, we have studied the actual charge of the triton, and we have performed an extrapolation also to the physical point, and we have seen that it matches the experimental value. So, and besides that, we are also studying the spectrum of Hilbert hypernuclei, like for example, the hypertriton or the lambda NN channels, which are very active research areas now in this hypernuclear research team. So thank you.
Thank you, Marc. It was a very nice talk. Does anybody have any questions, any pressing questions? Well, maybe I can start. I have quite a long list in here. I was surprised to see, for instance, when you're looking at this baryon mass dependent of the binding energies, and you have these two different formulas, this linear and this quadratic, is there really no way of, essentially these are two body bound states. You're looking at the mass of the carrier particle between these two body bound states? Is there no really no known dependence of how this goes with the mass of the baryon, or are you looking for something more fundamental there?
As far as I know, only if you assume that your system is bound six quark states, then you can find some formula. Like people have done that for the HD baryon case. They have extracted a formula using KPT and they can extrapolate to the physical point. But then if you assume, for example, that your state is two baryons, like a molecule bound, then it's more complicated and it is not known. I think also that if you are really near the physical point, people have found expressions on how the binding energy should depend on the baryon mass. But since we are talking about 400 or 800 MeV baryon masses, this is very far away. And it is really not known how this dependence behaves with the baryon mass.
Right, thank you. Any other questions? Well, I can ask another one then. would it make, so now you have your, you know, eventually at the end of this program, I mean, now you basically already have the quantities that characterize the potentials, at least at low energies. Would it make sense to now use these potentials? I mean, I know your competitors in the HAL QCD collaboration have used them to already looked at hypernuclear structure and I don't know, infinite matter. Would you say it makes sense to do that now?
Yeah, people has already done that. So people have taken the results, for example, at 800 MeV, and they have fixed a very simple baryonless EFT contact tens for two and three body systems. And they extrapolate and compute the spectrum of four, five, and six body systems up to a thin oxygen. So this is possible. But still, you still require very small uncertainties so that when you could propagate to very large systems, it does not explode and you get huge error bars. But yeah, this is possible.
A little bit related to this point where I am now. So you mentioned in your conclusion the disagreements with the whole QCD.
There's
progress in sorting this out. So can you say a little bit more? Or not?
Not really.
Okay.
I mean,
no, I was just curious about.
I mean, in principle, we are doing calculations which are better than the ones we have done before. So we can really talk about which is the main problem in our method, which is called the plateau problem. But in principle, people say that we don't really reach the plateau region. We still see some region where there are some excitistic contamination. And before we get there, we encounter the synotonic problem. The errors grow exponentially and we lose the plateau. So we are trying to do better than that, so we can really safely say that we extract the ground state energy and not some energy that is contaminated by some excited contaminations. So we are towards this.
Okay, but this is an improvement, let's say, on your side.
Yeah.
But still, there's some predictions where there's a disagreement, right, between the two ways of calculating, at least in the nuclear-nucleon sector.
Yeah.
So this is still a little bit farther away.
I mean, the also it's very tricky comparing lattice results at physical quark masses because it really depends on how you set your lattice spacing. So how you convert your lattice units to physical units, it really depends on the physical sector. So really, to really be sure, one should really compare quantities at the physical point where you know that your baryon mass has to be 140 and your nuclear 150. So it's really tricky also to compare quantities at the physical sector.
I see, thanks. So maybe the comparisons need to be better posed.
Yeah.
I see.
Any other questions? don't see any, so I guess everything was clear. Yeah. Thank you very much, Marc.
Yeah, thank you.
And see you everybody in 2 weeks' time for yet another seminar. All right, bye.
Bye.
Thank you, bye. Very good.
Bye.
Thank you, bye.
Bye.